welcome to our segment of Around Town. And here we are at a gorgeous facility, the Carpenters Training Center, heading out the parkway to the airport. This is a building that I'm sure a lot of our residents have seen time and again, driving to and from Pittsburgh or to and from Robinson Town Center or Greater Pittsburgh Airport itself. There's the Carpenters Union Hall and the Training Center all on the same acreage here on the parkway. They took ownership of this building. First full year was 2010, so we're into our third year out here at this training facility. And what you're going to see as we walk through the facility, talk to some of the instructors, talk to the teachers, is that this Carpenters Union is not just your typical union itself. A lot of people think of a Carpenters Union, someone who just uses a saw and a hammer, and you're soon to find out that that's far from it, from whether it's the heavy highway construction to the people doing the flooring to the metal studding work or the actual woodwork, the millwork. This is a group of individuals that helped build Pittsburgh. Without the Carpenters Union, there would be no Pittsburgh today. None of the buildings that you know of would be here. These are the guys and gals that put together these buildings from the ground up itself. So enjoy your time watching this. You're going to enjoy the facility, the looks of the facility. It's just absolutely state-of-the-art. It is the best in the country for a union training facility itself. So whether these are kids fresh out of high school or tech school that wish to get into a trade program, or these are people that have graduated college and want to get into the trade program itself, or whether these are other individuals, this is something that you will really come to like, this program.
We started the construction of this center in 2009. The training center, as we know it, has been around since the 40s, and it was started back then by a small group of gentlemen that started to put things together with our business community, with our Master Builders Association and our businesses, and it blossomed into what we have here today, which we have become, you know, a staple on the parkway here, and many people stop by and just inquire about what is it that we do in here, what is our training, and almost everybody that comes here ends up walking away saying, you're one of the most best hidden secrets that we have here in Pittsburgh.
We're signatory to the Carpenters, and the Carpenters, through this program, train the next generation for us to be able to use as a resource for our projects.
We have approximately 1,000 students across the state of Pennsylvania. We not only have this center, but we have one in Duncansville, Pennsylvania, and one in Lebanon, Pennsylvania. We have approximately 1,000 students throughout the three. This center houses around 700 of those students. And when we talk about the students or the apprentices that attend training here, we have seven different disciplines: the commercial carpenter, the heavy highway carpenter, the pile driver, the millwright, the mill cabinet carpenter, the interior systems, and the floor coverer. And all those different crafts are housed within this building, and all those students are trained here.
The facility is unbelievable. It's probably one of the best in the country. Obviously, it's brand new. It encompasses all of the different disciplines that the apprentice carpenters need to learn.
You know, our goal is to keep the program moving forward and make these guys try to become successful and accountable. And we're doing a lot of good things here at the training center.
The technology advances just as in any other field. And if we don't stay right up to speed with that technology, we'll fall behind. As we tour the training center today, you'll see many changes that have happened from things that were done in wood are now done in a component type product. You'll also see where computers have come into play with a lot of our woodworking equipment, And our safety has advanced so much from where I had started 35 years ago. From the day they start their apprenticeship program to the day that they retire, we stress safety in every component of the industry that we get involved in. And we pray on a regular basis that no one in construction is ever hurt doing their job. Well, to get through your apprenticeship is a 4-year program. The way that it works is it's an on-the-job training and a structured in-house training that we do here at the center. The way that it works is the student comes to the training center for a 1-week session approximately every 3 months. So let me explain like this. If you start in June, you would come to the training center, do a week of training. 3 months later, you would come back again to do another week of training. And in the interim between those two training sessions, if the economy is well and there's a lot of work out there, you'd be working in the field at your respective trade. You continue to do that for that year 2 more times, approximately every 3 months. And with the 4 weeks of training completed, along with 1,300 hours of on-the-job training, you've then satisfied that first year of apprenticeship, and you'll be advanced to your second year. Then once again, 4 weeks of training at intervals of approximately 3 months apart, and 1,300 more hours of training in the field will then grant you the move to the next year of training, and you do that for your third year and your fourth year, and then you become what's called a journeyman carpenter. At that point, you should be able to conduct yourself professionally in any of the things asked of you to be done on the job site. There is actually no cost to the student to come to this training. The way that it works is there's an initial outlay of money of $400, and what that does is this is what it affords you. You have to be drug free to attend this training. So there's a drug fee, testing fee that comes out of that. We also supply you with all the necessary books, computers, and some of the specialty tools that we use that comes out of that money. And then there's an initiation fee to get yourself signed up and get yourself going. Once you outlay that $400, there is no more fees for training. The way that our training is funded is through collective bargaining agreement with our contractors. Our contractors and us as a union work very closely together to keep perpetuating the existence of the skilled, safe, skilled, productive carpenter that's out there in the field to keep our industry strong and thriving. So the apprentice that comes to training has a small outlay at first, but for the rest of his career, he doesn't have to pay a dime for any of the training that we have here at the training center. We have no discrimination as to age, where you've been prior, whether you're a young lady or a young man. No matter who you are, you have opportunity to get into this program and to move yourself through this industry. The average age of our students are 28 years of age. A lot of the reason for that is because there's displacement out there in the work world, and they've come to us later. They've decided to make a career change and head towards construction a little later on in life. And there's a lot of underemployed people that come here that have maybe gone on to college and just haven't been fortunate enough to find a job within the profession that they've trained in, and they'll move into the construction industry and end up with a very a good job for their future.
Hi, I'm Mike Ryan. I'm the father of a former Bethel Park athlete. We were fortunate enough to have BPTV cover our home games. We took one of the CDs and forwarded it off to different coaches of schools my son was interested in. We had an immediate response, and my son was now very fortunate to be able to play college ball. And I credit BPTV for that. So I would recommend that you get a hold of your heads of boosters and talk to them about doing home games. It makes for a great recruiting tool. It's also a great gift for grandma and grandpa, and it's also a great keepsake for years to come. Contact BPTV and help them help you.
We're in the general carpentry shop. And in this shop, we try to teach the vast majority of our general carpentry skills, whether it is roof framing, wall framing, doors, hardware, trim work, cabinet installation setting, any of those types of things that you would historically think that a carpenter would do are done in this shop. This week we have in our shop second year apprentices who are working on roof framing projects. This is the third day of their training this week, so they've already completed two different types of roofs and they're on to their third type. They've completed a common and they've completed a shed, and they're now working on a hip roof. So there's a lot of mathematics that go with that, and the classroom brings the mathematics to the paper, and then we bring the paper into the shop and actually put the paper to the wood, and then the wood to make the rafters. So these guys are in their fifth week of training. They've been out in the field for a year now. Most of them have had a pretty successful year. Work has been pretty nice for us last year. And their skill levels are all over the place. What we try to do is we try to have the apprentices learn as much as they can about the dynamics of our trade when they're in the program, and understand that when they're out in the field, they have to hone those skills and become very proficient at what they do. We're in the rafter layout area, and Dave Plutt, our roof framing instructor, is working with one of our apprentices. Your name, apprentice? Joe. Joe's learning how to lay out some of his first rafters Joe's ever built. So I'd like Dave to explain a little bit about what he's teaching Joe here.
Okay, what we're doing here is we have our structure over here, and we have to find the span of our building to figure out the length of our rafters. Joe right now is working on our hip rafters. Yesterday we did the commons, today we're going to work on some hip rafters.
And this is also a component of what we do here. We try to teach every apprentice how to cut things properly and safely. Using a power saw is secondary to our trade. We use it continually. So Dave is gonna step him through it. And then what'll happen once he does this cut under his instructor's supervision, then he'll start to cut some on his own and do all of the layout by himself.
Okay, here we are in our door hardware shop. We actually have Scott here. He's actually laying out our door here for some hinge pockets. We're having him install a door, building a door from scratch. Morsing out the hinges, morsing out the jamb. Today, we're just morsing out the door today. We have a hinge template set up here, and Scott's gonna router this out. We already did the math on this, our layout. And this is a guide for our router to run around so our hinge pockets fit in there nice. Now with this router, you gotta be careful. He's already been trained on it. Yesterday, we went over on the safety of the router. Okay, Scott, let's get our router. Let's take our hinge template off, and we'll show him our next step. Okay, once we get our hinges routed out, we have to square up our hinges. We're using a box type hinge. So for our box type hinge, it doesn't have a round edge on it. So we're gonna use a corner chisel to clean up our edges so that we can go ahead and mount our hinges into our door. Once Scott's actually completed his project, he's gonna be swinging a door in the jamb. This jamb was already prepped with our hinge pockets in here, and the template is set up to adjust for the jamb and the door at the same time. We'll have him swing the door, adjust your reveals, make sure this is plumb, level, and square. Then we'll actually have him put a door stop on here, make sure the door shuts properly.
This area of our training center is set up to do all the finish type work that is done either on a residential project or our large commercial projects. This lock set that's being installed at this point, typically when our doors come to our buildings, all this prep work is done for us. But we do have the occasional time that this has to be prepped. So what Nate's doing is doing all the field drilling to prep for a cylindrical lock set. We have to be very careful. The doors that you see in the video, they're just blocks that are in a steel door, so we can do this over and over in our training experience. But when we have a door on a job, those doors can cost upwards of $1,000, $1,500. So we have to be very careful when we do the drilling, and that's what our experience is here today. How to drill the holes, how to gain all the components into it using some templates and some other apparatus to make it happen so it's done well. Now we're in our area where we do cabinet installation. On commercial buildings, we can have upwards of a couple thousand cabinets in some of our large buildings that get installed. And these cabinets have to be installed precisely. The architect then checks them out and makes sure everything is done properly. So that's what we spend time in the training center here, showing them how to do all the scribing and the drilling and the techniques of hanging the cabinets. We have Jeff right now that just got one cabinet set to go, and we're ready to screw that to the wall. And then we'll then move on to our base cabinets and our countertop to be set. This is a large component of our trade, and the work has to be done clean, neat, and organized on everything that we do, and we can't create damage. These cabinets have to go in and be done perfectly. This shop houses about six different elements of parts of our training program. Our training program is a four-year program where our students come back to the training center 17 weeks in that 4 years. This particular shop, by each student, is used approximately six times in that rotation. So the students will spend approximately 240 hours in this shop learning all the different components of the finished carpentry end of our business. We're in the concrete shop of the training center, and in the concrete shop we have multiple form systems that's used out in the field today. Years ago, wood was used most of the time in form building constructions, and form work is, I explain it like this, it's like a jello mold that you put the concrete in, you take it off, and you have the form that you left there in the hard concrete. So many of our commercial structures and many of the structures that we do, if you take a look at a power plant and you see the cooling towers, that's all concrete formwork that's formed by the carpenter to make that happen. All of our buildings that are built in downtown Pittsburgh or any of our surrounding areas in the state of Pennsylvania have formwork that's used in the foundations, and that's what we teach here. We have multiple form systems today that we'd like to show you. We have insulated concrete forms that we're going to demonstrate for you a little bit today here. We're going to show you some Simon's forms, which is a hand-built, hand-disassembled system. And the form that you may be able to see in the background of me here, it's a white form. It's called a Miva form system that is used in what's called a gang component, where the components are built on the ground, ganged up, and then they're lifted with a crane into place. So you'll see that here also. We're going to lift some panels up. We're also going to show you how we've become very productive in the form system process. We're going to show how formwork is put together, braced, and then how it's held together using a component called a tie. And we climb the form systems today, and we climb them very safely using body harnesses and also a lanyard that keeps us from falling if we would happen to slip off the form. So we'll show you those components today. This component is about 4 to 5 weeks of their time back to school. This is one of our largest pieces of work that we do in carpentry, and we need to be sure that we're proficient when we get out there and work for our contractors. Okay, what we have, this demonstration we're going to show you right now, is Casey is going to climb the form, and what Gary's going to do is feed the tie to Casey. This is how we become very productive. We don't have to build a scaffold. We're able to scale the form, work in any location we want to, and be 100% tied off as we do it. This is so necessary to make sure that safety is watched at all time with this type of form system. Each one of those panels that we have clamped together there weighs somewhere between 800 and 1,000 pounds. So we have to be sure that everything's safe and braced, and as our students climb it, they're getting used to how it feels to lean back and do work that's happening in the field. So when they get out there, they're ready to perform and get the job done. What's going to happen in this procedure is in the field, remember I was talking about gang forming a few moments ago, that what's laying on the floor there is a gang form. And it makes us very productive because we don't have to climb and build it in place. We build it laying down in a very comfortable position. And then our crane, which is simulated here by an overhead crane in our training center here, we're going to lift the panel, stay out of the way of it. We have one fellow operating the crane. The other fellow is going to handle the manipulation of the panel over into place. And we have a couple carpenters there ready to clamp it into place and get ready for the formwork and the form concrete that's going to pour into the form system. So what would be happening on the job is a crane operator would be operating the crane, moving the panel. You have a carpenter positioning it into place. And once it gets into place, we'll lower down onto the footer. And there are carpenters on the other side of the wall there that are getting ready to install the clamps that will hold that system into place.
My name's Patty Selby. Today I'm teaching a scaffold class. It's a four-day class. And right now they're doing tube and clamp scaffold. Like every day they're going to do a different type scaffold. I came here to take one of the first scaffold classes that they offered, and I started helping teach with scaffold first, and then now I'm here.
In this area, we're installing what's called a Simon's form system. And this system, it was state-of-the-art back in, I would say, the late 60s, early 70s. And this took the place of most of our wood form systems, and this was the state-of-the-art system back then. The systems that you saw preceding this are what's state-of-the-art today. That's what gives us the most productivity. But back then, this is the system that does it. So what these two young men are doing right now is learning how to put the keys. What you can see there in the system are ties, and those ties are what hold this system from spreading apart when the concrete goes inside. If you remember back a few moments ago, we had Casey pull a big, large tie up and shove it through the larger system. Now we're into a real state-of-the-art system. This is a styrofoam form system that gives you an R22 insulation value. And if you can see, the system has studs that are located right inside the foam. So you're able to screw your drywall for the interior of your structure right onto that foam. And on the exterior of the structure, you're able to put your outside water shield on top of that, be it brick, siding, whatever it may be. So this is a complete system where concrete gets poured in the walls, and then your system can be, all of your finished systems can go right on it. This is a system that's used in areas where there may be a lot of hurricanes and tornadoes, flooding, things like that. This system's very strong, and the house is very sturdy whenever it's finished built. It's starting to catch on around our area here. Down south and out west, it's used a lot more. Up in Canada, it's used a lot more. So we're learning how to do this, so we're state-of-the-art here, ready to go whenever our contractors get a job like this, and we're ready to move. One of the things that our men like about this is how light the panels are. It's a lot less strenuous for the physical makeup of us. We're out in the field every day slugging around things, but this is a nice break in the action using something light-duty like this. But once again, it's a form system. It's the same as the other systems that we've seen, but it's for a different application. What we have ongoing on behind us here are the apprentices are learning to do different types of stair construction. All the way to the left is a concrete stair form, and it's called cheek walls and steps that are poured monolithically. So in other words, you can pour the step part and the side walls at the same time, and you'll see those in a lot of our commercial buildings and some of our residential homes. Coming around to, you know, going clockwise there, you'll see a stair form that is that's a house stringer. In other words, you can't sweep it off. If you can't sweep off the side, it's called a house stringer. The sides of the steps are a solid component, and the next step is what's called a cutout stringer. So we teach how to do the layout work and the different types of structural stairs. We walk up and down stairs every day. They have to be very accurately put together. Just a small amount of change from one stair to another, you can trip on it. So our apprentices learn how to do that, do the building, do the mathematics, and get out there and build safe, solid stairs for everybody to use.
right now, folks, in our training center. We're in the weld shop, we call it, which is very much a combination shop for us. Numerous of our carpenters train out of here. We have the pile drivers, naturally. This is actually their shop where we're at. They do most all of their training in here. But it's also with the weld shop here, we incorporate the millwrights. They use this, but we're going to get a chance to visit their shop a little bit. We also have Heavy Highway. Those guys come through here because PennDOT requires those guys to have be certified welders. So they spend quite a bit of time in here. And then also our commercial carpenters actually get one full week of welding in their fourth year, because in the commercial field, as you're seeing, we're not just cutting wood, nailing nails. It's a lot of metal, fabricating, and all of our different facets of the trade. But what we have is we got a very nice weld shop here. There's we have like 24 weld booths. We have a state-of-the-art exhaust system, which is controlled by the arc strikes that you're probably seeing in the background. But these arc strikes, that our exhaust system, if there's only a couple of them, it only pulls a little bit of air. But if a lot of the weld booths are being used, it ramps up and takes all the air out of here. And I'm not sure if you can tell, but there's barely any smoke and hardly any smell in here. And there's quite a bit of activity going on.
My name's Tim Keenan, and I'm the instructor for the pile driver apprenticeship portion of the carpenter's training here in Pittsburgh. A pile driver is a person, hard to describe, we're what they call a specialty craft of the carpenters, but what we do is we work on primarily foundations, building foundations, bridges, locks and dams. We work on various retaining walls that you might see going up and down the highway. So we do a lot of, our skill sets tend to run more like you see here in the weld shop. We're not a carpenter in the typical sense where we deal a lot with wood and some of the things associated. Our medium, if you want to call it that, is kind of deals a lot more with steel. So some of our apprentices, when they come in, they deal more so with the welding skills that you see going on, cutting and welding. So that's kind of our strength. We also do a lot of rigging. So a lot of times the cranes that you see associated with various construction projects, we do a lot of rigging. So some of the training here, we deal a lot with that, the different applications. Every job requires different types of rigging that go along with it, just like the welding. So here we cover a lot of different phases. We cover some of the different gases that we might use for cutting. We do different welding processes, wire feed, stick welding, things like that. So, as I said, we're kind of a subspecialty of the carpenter. So when people think about that, they don't often think about how you build a building. So before you see the structure, oftentimes we're there, as an example, the PNC building that's being built right now. We were in there initially to build the retaining walls for the foundations. We drilled caissons. So even some of the drilling that goes on around here, maybe not the Marcellus shale, but nonetheless, we do a lot of drilling. So again, things that you don't think about as far as pile drivers or as far as carpenters, I mean. So that's kind of what our specialty is. So before you see the buildings, we're sometimes there and gone. So affectionately called the Marines of Construction.
Curtis Grimm, I teach millwrights. Millwright is the mechanics of the carpenter. Of the carpenter trade. This is our shop here, and the front welding shop over here is ours also. Here we teach machinery alignment, so our guys are able to go out into the industry and align machinery to close tolerances so it lasts longer, saves energy, saves money. We teach some small machining. We teach a lot of rigging. That's why we have the rigging prop here, so guys can practice rigging, lifting, the usage of all rigging hardware. It would be maybe power plants, steel mills, any food processing, dog food plants, water treatment places, stuff like that. Anything where there's any kind of machineries that move. Anything metal. We are the mechanics of the trade. Anything that moves is ours. Teach math, so guys can go out and work with close tolerances, set machinery at tight elevations, close tolerance.
We're in a milk cabinet shop right now. My name is Wayne Babjack. I teach the milk cabinet apprentices first through fourth year, and all the fourth year commercial guys come through for a stationary power equipment class. Stationary power equipment. I teach milk cabinet as far as, you know, all how to run all the equipment, as far as, you know, laying out and plotting coordinates and machining parts. I use the cabinets for our basics because it is milk cabinet program, but most of our guys work in a cabinet shop, so they're familiar with the parts and pieces to building cabinets. So the other projects that I use around the shop, it's to motivate. The canoe is a good motivator because we use it for hand skill exercises. First through fourth year, everybody gets to move through the program. And as they're moving through, they learn different types of adhesives and epoxies and, you know, different types of finishes, lacquers and spar varnishes. And then we're moving into, you know, using different types of, you know, planes and spoke shavers and scrapers, you know, to learn how to do the leveling out of parts and pieces. Our facility is state of the art. We have everything that's new and updated. The apprentices come through and they learn how to use modern technology and how to do it like we did in the olden days, you know, by hand with routers. We're constantly trying to make sure that they understand every shop you go to is not going to have this technology. You know, sometimes you're going to have to do it, you know, a little bit backwards. 2 years ago, I took a class after I knew how to run a CNC router, and it was just getting the optimum out of the software and being able to create different types of mesh objects and textures, and being able to do different types of tool pathing to create spheres and pyramids. And you're able to take and import bitmaps and create images and pictures. And whenever you do that, I get to fool with it, and by staining it and taking a little bit of paint and, you know, throwing some paint on it, not spending a lot of time, and just, you know, trying to bring out the contrasts in, you know, different mesh objects, extrusions, and textures. I was asked to tell you that I do have the greatest job. I have the pleasure of working with apprentices and journeymen every day, and I get to come in here and I get to play with all this equipment. I get to show them how to use it from start to finish. If something goes wrong and it breaks down, we got to show them how to repair it. We show them how to change out the cutter knives on all the molders. If we have something that breaks down in a shop, you got to be able to maintain it and fix it. I do get to play with all this stuff. You know, I get to do cool things, canoes, get to do the cabinet work, but I still get to play with a little bit of the stuff like the guitars, making signboards, and all the fun stuff. The canoe has, you know, ribs and a beam, and that's the basis of the structure. That's actually what we use as our foundation to build the canoes. And then once you got that foundation built, it's just laying the pieces and then applying all the trim work. And, you know, you have a fantastic project when you're done, and the apprentices go, hey, I worked on that. I did that.
Where we're at now in the Carpenter Training Center is we're in what we call our interior-exterior system shop, which the carpenters, the commercial carpenter, a lot of what he does is interior systems. And in today's world, we see a lot of metal studs. We see a lot of drywall, ceilings, door hardware, things like that. So that's some of the things that are done in this shop that our guys are working on. But another one of our features is behind me, you see some plastic and some tape and that red zipper. Kind of unique to Carpenters and job sites, but if you've ever been into a healthcare facility, that's what we're trying to train here. Another one of the aspects that we do in the interior systems shop is we teach in metal studs, drywall. We have some folks here working this week, some of our second year apprentices. They're working on bulkheads, which a lot of people kind of take for granted, bulkhead ceilings. Unless you're looking up, most of us are looking down as we walk through a building. But we as carpenters, when we look at some of the different commercial buildings, we see bulkheads and ceilings. They're very intense, and we know what it takes to get those in above our ceilings, and that's what some of our apprentices are being trained on this week. We also do metal stud walls. Like I said before, we do door jams. We swing doors. We also do various layout in our interior systems, radius layout, You know, we teach the guys how to bend drywall. We have equipment that we use, leveling equipment, pointers, which is laser pointers, laser levels, and things like that.
My name is Dan Solomon. I'm the floor covering coordinator instructor. Today we're doing resilient sheet flooring. It's their second time for resilient sheet flooring. They're learning how to make seams. They're learning how to pattern scribe material into walls and obstacles. We teach everything but the really hard surface flooring like ceramic. We do everything from hardwood flooring through resilient sheet flooring to resilient tile into carpeting. They do 5 weeks a year for 4 years for a total of 20 weeks of training.
My name's Bob Gibson. I'm the Heavy Highway Carpenters Training Coordinator and Instructor for Carpenters Local Union 2274. We basically cover 60 counties in greater Pennsylvania. We're one of the locals that has the largest jurisdiction in the state because we are what you would call a specialty contractor. And what our specialty is concrete. First question that people ask me when they say, what do you do for a living? And I tell them I'm a carpenter and I build bridges. They say, they still build bridges out of wood? And I say, no, you have to understand that concrete has to be formed and cast. And the work of a heavy highway carpenter is to install those forms for all of the bridges and the structures that you see around the city. We're the guys that a lot of people don't like because when you see those cones come up in the spring, that's when we go to work. Some of the bigger jobs that you've seen in the area recently would be the Squirrel Hill tunnels. All the concrete work that's going on in the Squirrel Hill tunnels is of course being installed by heavy highway carpenters. Some of the what I call Discovery Channel type work that we've done recently is the tunnel that has the light rail transit that's going into the city over to the North Shore. That is also the work of the heavy highway carpenters. And then our biggest feat that was only done once in the history of the Army Corps Engineers was the Braddock Lock and Dam. We actually built a dam in Leechdale, turned it into a concrete boat, floated it down the river, and then sunk it right below Kennywood in Braddock and turned that into the new lock chamber and the dam on that particular stretch of the river, which produces a lot of our work because we do all the inland waterways work, which is the dams, the locks. The majority of our work is bridges, though. I mean, Western Pennsylvania is number one in the world for the number of bridges per square mile. Venice used to be number one, but we surpassed them a number of years ago. And in Venice, the bridges are very small, but in Western Pennsylvania, the bridges are very big. In addition to that, our apprenticeship program is a four-year program. We use all of the different form systems that are within the training center facility because when you do concrete, all the contractors have their own form system that they like to use and that they're familiar with. So our members have to be versatile with all the form systems. It does not matter whether it's an EFCO system or a Perry or a DOCA or a MEVA or a Gates or even the original formwork, which was always wood forms. We still use those in a lot of the structures that we built. The majority of our training for the apprentices, if you would get into the program, is done in the middle of the winter. When you first get into the program, a first-year apprentice has to actually learn how to build the bridge that's behind me. This is their very first project that they do. They come out, we teach them basic carpentry skills, how to saw, cut, nail, make sure they know how to measure. And then once they progress with that, we do smaller form projects, and eventually we come up to this bridge project. So they have to learn all the terminology, learn how to form in the footers, the abutment that goes on top of it, beam seats, and learn all the names of the parts of the bridge. They come back in second year and they get other training. They get scaffolding, they get aerial lift training, they get OSHA 10 training, plus an additional amount of blueprint reading and math. Third year, they get a lot of welding. They get rigging. They also get first aid and CPR in third year in our program. Because even though we're carpenters, carpenters form in the deck on a bridge similar to this with metal angle an SIP decking, which is installed by the Carpenters, and that's actually what supports the concrete deck that we drive on our highways. So there's also a lot of welding involved in the heavy highway trade. When they come back in fourth year, they get some specialty forms. They learn how to build stairs. They learn how to build concrete decks that are supported by falsework, which then gets removed. They also learn how to put the overhang on this bridge, which is always concrete, how to set up the piece of equipment that actually establishes and does the finishing of the grade. They also install the edge of deck forms, which we call a parapet, but it's the concrete structure on the side of the bridge that keeps you from driving off going into the river. Once they complete that and they pass a fourth year final test, there will be awarded journeyman status.
Hi, I'm John Bauer, and I'm here to talk about sudden cardiac arrest. Heart disease, including sudden cardiac arrest, is the nation's number one killer. Sudden cardiac arrest happens when the heart suddenly stops beating. This may be from a heart attack or a number of other causes. Whatever the cause, without immediate action, the sufferer will die. You can take action against sudden cardiac arrest. If you see someone suddenly collapse and it looks like they aren't breathing normally, you need to act immediately. First call 911 or your local emergency number. Then start immediate chest compressions. Place your hands in the middle of the chest and begin to push forcefully and rapidly, at least 100 times a minute. If anyone else is nearby, have them relieve you after 2 minutes. Keep taking turns. If you're in a public place, ask someone to get an AED. When it arrives, open it up and follow the voice instructions. Don't stop chest compressions until the AED tells you to. Keep going until rescuers arrive. Sudden cardiac arrest is survivable if immediate action is taken. You can make a difference. To learn more or to learn CPR, contact Tri-Community South EMS at 412-831-3710. Be a lifesaver. Learn CPR.
Hey, ready?
Of course I am.
What are you waiting for?
I was waiting for you.
So we're gonna continue the puppy thing real quick.
Okay, places everyone.
In a minute!
Do I have to do everything myself?
You can't do it all by yourself.
I'd say,
sure I can.
No, he can't. And neither can I. So why don't you come on down to BPTV and help us make some of the great community programs you see on this station every day.
Yeah!
I mean, we can help you make your TV show ideas a reality.
It's pretty awesome.
So, come on down. I mean, I am pretty good. But I'm sure I can use your help.
Carpenter's application process, the way that it works is you can come to our training center and apply. We are now accepting applications year-round at our training center, and it's on Wednesdays. And the process is $25 and your driver's license gets you the application. Once you apply, it's done right here at the training center, then you are scheduled for a test. Then you come in and you take a general knowledge test. And once that test is completed, it's then graded and evaluated, and then you're brought in for an interview. That entire process creates a scoring system, which then helps to in the selection process of the apprentices that are brought into the program. So it's a very simple process to our training center: apply, test, interview, and if the economy's doing well enough, hopefully we bring in large groups. We don't take everyone that applies. We wish we could. The economy plays a huge role in that. If there's a lot of work out there, obviously the fruits are much better. We're able to bring a lot more people in. That's why we always hope for a robust economy and a good building season every year. I said the wrong word, season. We don't have seasons anymore. With the way equipment is today, we can continue to build year-round. But the opportunities are great when the work is great. When it's not, they're not. And what we don't do is sell a false bill of goods. We don't just bring students in just to have them and pump up our numbers. We try to run a very close relationship with the probability of employment to the amount of students that we take. We not only have young high school students that have come out of our area high schools, but we have people that have come through our VOTECs. Also, we have college graduates from many different professions. Teachers end up changing their profession or just weren't fortunate enough to find a position. Accountants, believe it or not, we have some attorneys. We have architects that have come to the Carpenters. So we have many different professions that have changed their profession and come to the Carpenters for their career. We are working on a program as we speak to increase our credits to 42 credits. So you'll only be 18 credits shy of an associate degree. So every student that comes through our program will leave this program with 42 college credits through CCAC of Allegheny County. Once that's accomplished, when you're a third-year apprentice, you can go on to continued education in construction estimating and construction supervision that can land you an associate degree at that point, which can then be used to market yourself into the business side of our industry.
I came to the training center with the thought that help some of these guys find their way, and I'd like to think we've done that.
One of the things I'm very proud of being a union carpenter is we take care of ourselves when it comes to our medical, our pension, and handle those tough decisions within our own walls. It doesn't become an us and them scenario. We take care of all those tough decisions in-house, and we keep production out in the field.
I've been involved in the union. I've been an officer out of my local for 27 years, 28 years now. And so I've been on the union side as an officer. I've been running work, know what it takes to make these contractors money, but also with the understanding that we still sit on the labor side of the table, and we need to, do the right things for the organization so that our contractors make money and keep us successful.
It's a huge difference having a great labor that we can depend on and well-trained labor that understands safety, probably first and foremost importance to our company and our industry is the safety, and the carpenters through the apprenticeship program do a great job.
We are very positive in our outlook for the carpenters and for the apprenticeship program to get stronger and larger. We're hoping that the Marcellus Shale industry in our area produces the refinery that we're hoping to have happen in the Beaver County area. And if that happens, that will just add a huge influx of work for us because of all the support things that will happen be past that. We're not only looking at that plant, but we're looking at all the manufacturing plants that could be built and supported through the construction trades of the city and the carpenters. We feel proud that we are able to get our large structures, get our city moving forward in a timely manner. Whenever we were building the stadiums back in the early 2000s, they already knew when opening day was. So it wasn't like we can go over on that deadline. They knew when they were going to kick the first football and knew when they were going to throw the first pitch. So those buildings had to get done and ready for opening day, as with every other building that we build and hope to build in the future. Any time that there's a very strict schedule that we need to get a quality project done, we feel that we can produce that. Any kind of training that needs done, we feel that we can get that training here at the training center and disseminate it out to our membership.
our segment of Around Town. I hope you've enjoyed as much as I have being out here at the Carpenters Training Facility today. I think it opened a lot of eyes to just what our Carpenters Union does for the city of Pittsburgh and all of Pennsylvania and this entire country itself. So I want to thank Ricky and his staff for allowing us to spend the day with him, and I hope you got out of the program as much as I did. We'll see you again on the next segment.